Today is the 26th of October 2011. We're at the Wesley Senior Healthcare Center. We are doing an interview today with Dr. Leo Hoge and with Minnie Bolster. And we're going to be doing reminiscences about Saratoga. And who would like to start first?
Well, how long have I known Dr. Hoge? Well, since he came back from the war and came in our office.
Well, way before the war, it seemed to me you used to call me Dr.
Well, you were my doctor for a short time.
That's right. And then,
he took the water off, I think, right?
So kindly. His handwriting would not be, many would call me, so I could translate his handwriting. She had sent her a medical report, but she could, she said, I can't read his writing. So I would show Kylie?
Well, I must say right here, all the doctors, none of the doctors could write at that time. And the lawyers weren't much better.
How about Mike?
Well, he was a terrible writer.
And he doesn't want an answering machine. If my answering machine had any call, he'd hang up. And he never liked to write his drafts or dictate because he had a machine. And he had the way he would dictate, and many would.
I shouldn't tell you this, but I'm going to. The office, Bill Ford, I guess, at the office decided to get a machine. Well, my boss couldn't straighten out the phones. He was still calling me from the door when he finished. So he didn't want to use it. And I didn't want to use it. So he dictated on the machine to me, and he left it on my desk, and he went up to Port Henry for the day. And when he came back, he had on his desk exactly what he said, where he said it. He never used it again.
Well, that is,
and I never did either.
Not of his drafts, he read handwritten, wouldn't he?
No, Mike's writing was bad, but I could read it because I read it all those years. But they were very good writers, the boys. Mm-hmm. And when I go to the hospital to copy charts and things, that was almost impossible to copy, to copy the charts because the doctors were, you know, they all didn't have a computer on their knee like they do today.
In high school, yeah.
Yeah. But anyway, it was a good job, and I loved it.
That was unusual. Now, were you with Mike for 43 years?
Almost 45.
Almost 45.
And they never paid me a salary.
They never?
Well, he
well,
never
judge.
Paid me. Well, I used to kid him. I worked all those years for you. Never paid me a salary.
Well, how'd you make it?
Well, the Larry Bullard's office paid me the first 21 years. And then the state paid me the second 24.
Now, this lady has really history. This is history. It's important.
Yeah,
history.
That's important history. Anyway, I was very fortunate to be in the right place. And I went in the office in 1939. After two summers in the telephone company and one partial year at an Eastman business. And I graduated from Eastman and went to the telephone company, and the last day they asked me to work 2 weeks into the vacation. And the day I got through, the next day I went to work at Larry Ford. And I worked all my life.
Now, did you were you born in Saratoga?
I was born on Marvin Street, across from the back of the hospital, across from it.
Jim Larry was probably the biggest man in Saratoga. He owned probably half of Saratoga. A very difficult man, and I know him personally through Mike. That's how I got to know him.
It was difficult with you because you were a doctor.
The only other person that was like him was Rickover, Admiral Rickover, who I worked for over here. Oh, I was with him right up until 1980.
What was that?
Admiral Rickover, father of the nuclear submarine.
Oh, okay.
And he never said goodbye on the television. Slammer, he was out. And you know, these engineers were clever, clever guy. Nuclear. This is a high point of my life, working for Rickover. Because these guys, clever, most cleverest people ever. And still I hear from them, some of them. Most of them died off now. But they were great people, you know, always with a sense of humor. And he, but he came, when he would come up there, he said, West Melton with us, and he had the old Navy raincoat he wore, and then there were seven guys behind him, single file, just like Indians, or single file. And he'd go into the chemistry lab and complain to these guys and tell them how bad they're doing, and curse and swear at them. I don't know how they could take it. Chris is swearing at these very clever guys. And one guy had the, I got to know him very well, Dr. Pitzer. And he said, you know, that Larry was impossible. He just told him one time, I want you to make something that's indestructible. He came up with screwy ideas. So this guy, he went to work determining something that was indestructible. And finally, when he over to the next, say, have you got that, completed that project? I said, yes, sir. Well, where is it, sir? And he handed it over to Rickover. There was a radiator there. Rickover, he smashed it on the radiator. Pieces flew all over the room. You'll have to do better than that. Now, there was a good friend of mine, Joe Bomer, clever guy, wonderful guy, dedicated to his work. But, you know, he got called every, all kinds of names. You know, and then he'd be talking to some guy, what does your father do? My father's a minister. Well, what are you doing here in the nuclear program? You should be a minister. Get the hell out of here. And if he didn't go out, he'd have him sitting in a judge's locker room. Then finally, you bring that guy back in. He just wasn't responding properly to me. But that was the thing there. So Joe Bomer was a clever, clever guy. And he couldn't take it. And he eventually did quit. And he became the president of Hudson Valley Community College. And when he retired, I went over to the telecommunication building there, beautiful big building, is named the Joe Bomer building. But Joe would be walking across the campus, they told me, there's some paper lying on the floor. He'd pick it up. And so we got to keep a place looking spick and span, you know, Rickover. Because Rickover would be making an inspection tour up here, and there'd be some Christmas decorations falling down back of the refrigerator. Come on, you got to clean this place up. And everybody was out there talking to Rickover. You enjoy him because he was, but he was a very difficult, but he got the job done. Now in Japan, they had a man operating those power plants. I don't believe they would have had heat, because, and, you know, the Russians, Chernobyl, because they didn't know how to, but Rickover got the job done, and he was always very proud of the fact that nuclear ships had sailed 24 men steam, 24 miles under nuclear power, and we never lost a nuclear submarine. Now we did lose, the threshold came Cape Cod, but that was a weld. And when that they discovered that it was a weld, don't you think they, every welder that took it, they x-rayed it. Well, x-ray. And so it's never gonna happen again. And then the Scorpion, we hit, that was at Windsor Box, I was responsible for that one too. Anyway, the Scorpion went down off the Azores. She'd been in the Met, coming back, they stopped there, and off the Azores, defeated. That was 3,500 feet. That's way, way down. And nobody knew it where it was. They knew where it was. Now my son, Scott, was with SOSIS. He's stationed down in the Bahamas. And we got these buoys over the whole Atlantic Ocean. And when a ship comes out from Gibraltar, it's got a signature. And they could identify that ship from the signature. Say, what interesting work you're doing. And then eventually he was there for 2 years, and then he was up in ADAC, halfway between Alaska and Siberia, and doing the same type of those Russian submarines and ships going up. Interesting. But anyway, because of this program, the Navy chiefs, you know, they're very good. They can treat a patient, they can do so many things, order medicines and all that, you know. But when they retire, they got to start all over again. They got to begin to take up gardening or landscaper or something else. I thought we got right, because chiefs are clever people. So I went over to Bell and said, you should have a program for a Navy chief when he's ready to retire. Yeah, so they were sort of agreeable to it. I went up to Albany Medical College, and there's a dean up there I knew. I can't give you his name now, but I knew him real well. And I said, I should develop a physician's assistant program. So I was made on the committee with Hudson Valley, and they paid me. I think they paid me some money to attend these meetings and advise them. And that program developed. And I got a certificate home saying appreciation of the work for the established physician's assistants. The physician's assistants could just about do anything that a doctor didn't do. And you guys are very clever. Enough of Leo Hoge. Minnie, come on, ask Minnie some questions.
I have a question for the two of you. Okay. Minnie, let's start with you. What's the greatest change you've seen in the city since you lived here? Like things that you like and things that you don't like that have changed.
Well, I suppose you could say all the buildings, with due respect to Rick. But that doesn't bother me. Uh-huh. It bothers a lot of my friends. But I always say this, back in the 1870s, everything on Broadway was two-story wood.
1870?
Yes, that's before me.
Oh.
And back in the 70s, everything on Broadway was rebuilt, brick and high. And we love it. So let's hope 50 years from now they're going to love Railroad Place. But it doesn't bother me because I think it's changed. But, well, everything's changed. I loved the high school when I went on Lake Avenue.
What year did you go,
Biddy? I graduated in 38.
I was 33.
I was only 17. That's pretty good.
Very good.
What else do you want to know?
How about on Broadway? What stores did you like on Broadway, or what businesses did you like?
Well, I loved McGurr's and Starbucks.
How about Walter's ice cream store?
Well, of course, that's a different thing. They had the best ice cream in town, and they had good candy. They made candy too, and the candy kitchen was great. We were there all the time.
How about Quinn's Coffee Shop at 3 o'clock in the morning in August?
Where?
Quinn's.
Huh? Quinn's Coffee Shop on Broadway.
I don't remember that.
Well, this. See, you were probably around on Broadway at 3 o'clock. I was. I was at the Rip and Dam Hotel. Went on duty at 9 o'clock at night till 6 in the morning, and all the.
Oh, you mean Kings? Kings? You said Queens.
Quinn's.
Quinn
was the
Quinn's.
Owner.
Quinn's. Oh,
because the Quinn brought my mother's.
Oh, the coffee thing. Shop, yes.
My mother's had the Colonial.
Yes, the Colonial.
Quinn bought
Quinn's
that.
Was where Division Street meets Broadway.
Oh, okay.
Excuse me.
And there was a Palace Theater and Quinn's Coffee Shop. And when they closed, they moved down the street and called it the Colonial. It was an interesting time.
Who changed it? Hmm? My mother founded the.
I know she did. Okay. She had a tea room.
She'd be arguing. She was also very proud of the Dutch heritage because her father came from Amsterdam, Holland. And we always had wooden shoes by the door. Visitors come, she put the wooden shoes out, crawl around. And then she had me on the Dutch cleanser. Remember, there was a little Dutch girl.
Yeah.
and we just get some plywood, carved it up, and then I'd paint it. She said, the Dutch are the best, the cleanest, the best people. You know, they put the poop on the stoop, and it's picked up in the morning. In those days. Let's get back to it.
Let's get back to Saratoga.
Sanitary subject.
All right, how about this? When the when the great hotels were still on Broadway, the Grand Union, the United States.
Oh, marvelous.
When they came down, was it sad or did it feel like...
Well, it was part of the...
I don't remember us feeling much of anything.
Yeah.
That's what I remember of when the States was to come down.
Oh.
There was a... I still have a picture of the Saratoga about that big. Something to the effect, if you've got anything to say, say it now. And at that time, what were you going to do with that?
Right.
There was nobody had money. They were out of date. It was just after the war in the 40s, and everybody that wanted to had a car and stayed in the motel or wherever they could drive in and get out and go. They were out of date.
Yeah.
It was sad, I suppose. I was only in the United States was kind of inaccessible with all those stairs.
The bar.
Well, I never went to the bar.
tell them about where Mike Sweeney got the best ballot.
Where he got what?
The ballot. The bar at the United States Hotel was taken down, and while it was some guy in Saratoga.
Oh, the Ferrone boy, Frenchie Ferrone. Well,
Frenchie Ferrone.
First, let me say this.
Oh,
when the hotel burned in 1874, it took them, that may be a little later, it took them 7 years to rebuild it. And it was a hole from Broadway to Division Street. And I have a picture showing it, and it was rubble. It must have been very disheartening. And somebody built a little shack, just a shack, on the corner, and I don't know what it was supposed to be, but that's all was on that lot all those years. And then they rebuilt it in 74, and of course it became gorgeous. When it was torn down in 46, Frenchie Ferrone built a bar on the corner, right on the sidewalk, on the corner. It might have been called the U.S. Bar. I can't remember. I think so. But it was the front of it was all big glass bricks. Is that what you call them? Brick. And you could see through them, the lights. So if you were sitting in there, you could see the bar and all the lights. But it was awful. It was awful. I mean, here we had that gorgeous, great big place, and then we had a little glass brick bar. It was terrible.
Just let me say one word, Minnie. At the entrance, right, there are two statues on Broadway at the entrance to the United States Hotel. Beautiful. And it was such a nice place that she's telling you about. They even made a movie called The Saratoga.
Saratoga.
Who was it?
I saw them when they were making it.
Did you see that?
Well, I saw them making it. On the way to the bank one day, Clark Gable Betty Grable, I guess.
That was Saratoga Trunk, wasn't it?
Saratoga Trunk.
Well,
was a gala.
Wait. Saratoga was made on Broadway in front of the States. I don't remember where they made the other one. It probably was made in Saratoga, but I have the movie, but I have no recollection of it. But the Saratoga was made, it was Jean Harlow's last movie. And she and Clark Gable were getting into a little car out front. And a couple of my friends, older, have told me since, they were paid to walk by as part of the walk, you know. But,
Saratoga, the history of Saratoga is a great, great history.
Did you read my second book?
No, I haven't.
Well, you should, because that'll tell you about Saratoga.
Really good. What was it like? What was it like when you walked into the big hotels?
Well,
was it just
I was going to.
Well, you didn't. Saratoga didn't walk.
Well, I was going to tell you. I was only in the United States once.
Huh. Saratoga.
Because I came down from vacation and I rode down with a couple who were going to stay there overnight. They left me off at home, but something was left in the car. And he called me and I went down to pick it up, and I walked up the steps, went in the office and picked it up. That's all I remember, except it was elegant. The Grand Union was on the sidewalk. There were two or three steps and you walked in, and it was much more accessible. And then of course we all went to dances there after, toward the end, and car sales. They put all the cars in the ballroom and showed them off. They were entirely different.
Huh.
And I don't remember the other one. It went down in 1912.
But Saratoga, we always feel we're just a little bit better than any of these other towns. We have the history. And one time I was attending a meeting, I ended up my career with an old town in Brickover, Saratoga, and we were having meetings connected. And at the conclusion of the meeting, Bolster, he said, "You live in Saratoga?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Did you know that Stonewall Jackson was in Saratoga?" And have you heard me tell this story? I told you the story. I'll repeat it again. You don't need to remind me.
Oh,
so anyway, before I had a chance to question him about it, he disappeared in the crowd. But when I get home, I never heard Stonewall Jackson. So I go to Minnie Bolster, not Minnie Bolster, but B. Sweeney. B. Sweeney, she knew the history of Saratoga. That's where she went, the history of Skidmore and all of that. I said, "Did Stonewall Jackson ever come and say, 'Come on, there's up, I was crazy'? Forget it." But I don't, it was something, this guy was serious. So I went down to the post office, not the post office, the library. They have a book on Stonewall Jackson. And they got it for me. And I read this book, Stonewall Jackson, in 1851, now that's before the war, he married Mary Ann Morrison from South Carolina. Now, he was a very religious person. He and Robert E. Lee, actually Lincoln questioned Robert E. Lee to take over the Northern forces. But Robert Lee said, "No," he said, second in his class at West Point, he said, "No, I'm from Virginia. I'm going to be with my people." So he took the Confederacy. But at any rate, that was, I got this book of Stonewall Jackson. And he married this gal, and they came up, going north. They came to New York, being religious like he and Robert Lee. And he went to Trinity Church, beautiful church. And after that, they came up into New York, and they came to Saratoga Springs. Now, in those days on Broadway, even in those days, 1851, it was a big, big town. Broadway, Gideon Putnam had all these people coming from the South to come up here. A lot of social life. But what impressed Robert Stonewall Jackson, the beauty, not that social stuff, he didn't like that at all, but the trees, nature.
Saratoga is a beautiful place. They came for the springs.
No, well, this is just...
In 1840s and 50s.
Well, I'm talking about Stonewall Jackson.
Yeah, he came here.
Yeah, well, he was here, but let me finish my story. But he was so impressed by the nature, the tree, the beauty here. And then he took his bride out to Saratoga Lake, and he got rid of the boat, and he rode her around on Saratoga Lake, admiring the beautiful water lilies on Saratoga Lake. That's Stonewall Jackson. And now I'm living at Stonewall Jackson, out there in the lake, where it was Stonewall Jackson. So he was here, there's no question about it. You agree with me?
Well, I agree, because everybody was here. Everybody who was anybody was here at Saratoga.
That's right.
There's no question about it.
Right up until recent times.
Yeah.
And as you know in those articles that in my book, everybody came. I mean, if you did come to, and speaking of that, in my day, if we went to New York and somebody said, like during the war and all, "Where are you from?" We used to say upstate New York for a while. And then we found out if you said Saratoga, everybody knew where Saratoga was, even then.
But what used to surprise me, these people from, this is a fairly recent time, but not too far back, people from Long Island, the city, come up here, and Saratoga's are goats. We don't know the score at Saratoga. They know the whole story. But now it's changed. They're moving up here, and they're buying property here in Saratoga, and in Vermont, too.
If you come to
they
Saratoga.
Changed their mind. We're not ghosts after all. We actually know the score.
Now, if you come to Saratoga, nobody leaves.
Yeah,
that's right.
Mm-hmm. Particularly Skidmore. Nobody goes home from Skidmore.
President Moore of Skidmore used to, when they have a new professor, he always took a wrote about Saratoga Lake, the beautiful Saratoga Lake. Especially on those hills on the east side where there used to be dairy farms. And Gerard King, who had the big new ones and the gambling part and all that business, he said when he had time off, he and another friend of his used to ride horseback up on those hills overlooking Saratoga Lake. Beautiful. And it is a beautiful ride.
Have you seen the new bridge?
I live on Saratoga Lake.
I forgot. I know you do. You missed it for about a year.
For a year, I was driving on Fitch Road. You know, ordinarily, I live at the north end.
That's a nice road, but it's a long way around.
6 minutes from my house to the racetrack, 9 minutes to Broadway. Oh. But when that bridge was being repaired,
I forgot
that. It took me half an hour to get to Broadway. And a bad road. Boom, 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 boom. Okay, shimmy.
What was Saratoga like during the war years?
Dull.
Dull?
I was kind of lucky. In my job, we had a Schenectady office. And the girls in Schenectady, the secretaries, there were two down there, and they quit regularly to go to Alco or GE or someplace else for big bucks. So me, whose boss was in the service, got sent to Schenectady. I went by trolley, and the trolley was over a, what do you call that? When it went over that high thing?
Trestle.
On the way into, well, by the time you got to Schenectady, you were awake, but you weren't happy. And I went to, the alternative was Mr. Leary would call me up if he had to be at Schenectady, and he'd say, I'll be at the corner of Fowler Street, 5 minutes, be there. So I would ride down with him, which was interesting. I liked him. And I'd go to Schenectady and I'd work Monday, Tuesday, well maybe Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. And then I had to come back to Saratoga and do all the book work because the bookkeeper up here had left. And I wasn't a bookkeeper, but I became one under Bud Lynch.
She ran.
I did not. Anyway, so I worked at Schenectady during the war, Schenectady was very busy, of course, GE. But Saratoga, the hotels were closed, and a couple of years the racing was closed. And
I understand there was a veterans hospital here.
Yes, the one up at Mount McGregor. You mean that one?
Well, there was one at the Roosevelt Baths.
There's one.
The Washington
Inn. The Baths.
McCarty House.
There was one down there. But there was also Metropolitan ran a hospital on Mount McGregor. Mm-hmm. And then after the war, there was a veterans place up there. And I don't know, it was dull. Broadway was just dull.
Sorry, I got a call to you.
What did he say?
He said he heard the siren, he said, I have a call.
What about the gambling establishments? Were they going full tilt during the war?
I wouldn't have had any way to know, but I doubt it.
Unless you're a
friend. In town, you did. The gambler, the horse rooms at the...
12 months of the year, horse rooms.
The what?
Horse rooms were open 12 months of the year.
Yeah, the horse rooms
restaurants.
Were open. We had Peppers at Vic Urquhart's and, I don't
know. Congress Street.
There was one on Fowler Street. I lived up on Fowler Street, right off Broadway. And the next place down was the Kentucky Club, which was a Horschel.
That was Woodlawn Avenue, wasn't it?
Leo White. White.
Chicago
was. That was on Woodlawn. But the one on Flower Street, I used to park my car in the backyard of what is the, was the Colonial, because I lived in one of those apartments. And on Friday, when I got paid, well, my, as bookkeeper, I moved it up to Wednesday. We got paid on Wednesday for the rest of the time. Anyway, I used to go in there in the back door and get my check cashed. Now, that's as close as I ever got. But I knew Allie White. I knew
Allie him. White, Jim Fettle?
And Jim Fettle was on Broadway.
Oh, you got a straw hat on.
He was on Broadway with his social. And then McGurr had a cigar shop of some kind, and there was gambling in the back room. Because I have one of those chalkboards that came out of it. So he didn't need that for cigars. And then Phil, all of the bookstores.
Who had the place down on Caroline Street? Peppers?
Peppers. But Peppers ran up. He was big time. But he ran a place on
Connecticut. I'm not going to tell.
Mr. Pepper used to come out, you know. Everybody knows Mr. Larry got paid. If they opened, he got paid. We know that. I don't know how. I don't know Mr. Larry never went and collected. I know that. There's a book out today that says he did. Ridiculous. But Mr. Pepper used to come in on Sundays. We were open on Sundays. And he had a gorgeous, great big dog. And he'd come in and he'd sit in one of our old chairs and the dog would sit there. And the dog would come over every half hour. They had to wait. He'd come over and talk, let me pet him, and he'd go back. And Mr. Pepper went in and saw that Mr. Larry took his dog with him. Now, what was he in there for? I mean, you didn't have to be a mental giant, you know? Let's face it.
But how about Dr. Key and Dr. Leonard?
Who? Dr. Leonard? He took care of the city, and Mr. Larry took.
If you had a problem there, a financial, any kind of, you see that, you go to the side door, I've been there, and you see Dr. Leonard, and he'll get you squared away, regardless of what your problem is.
You must have been a Democrat.
No, everybody was, well, of course, you had to be a Democrat when you're talking. Now, Dr. Leonard had a, was it his sister that was a nun or something? Dr. Leonard's sister was a nun.
One of them. The other one was married to Bill.
Jim Leary. When I die, I'm not going to have, don't waste money on the pasty money and all that. Just a pine box, that's all I want. That's what he told me, I heard. And of course, when he died, Ruth Wallace, they had the priests there and spent thousands of dollars and money went to the Pope. I guess I read Ruth left the money to the Pope.
Mr. Larry had a priest that he was buried from his home.
Were you there?
Yes.
I wasn't invited.
So I was there.
Trustee is really on the inside. That's the important.
Not really, but we were.
You really were.
Huh?
You really were.
I was there. It was up at his house and we had the service. And then nobody went any place. He was buried in St. Peter's, as far as I know. But he, that was because of Ruth. He didn't care. I don't know where Dr. Leonard is.
Would you say, Mindy, that was he one of the most powerful people in town?
Absolutely. Well,
I say this often. If we had Mr. Larry and Dr. Leonard today, we wouldn't have any problems. Wow. They ran the city and the county. They did.
Absolutely.
There's no question. As far as back as when I was little, my grandmother died when I was 11, and I can remember her waiting for Dr. Leonard to send us turkeys or chickens. Didn't get turkeys. Now that's, and I doubt my grandmother voted. She didn't have time taking care of the rest of it. But, he just took care of people, and Mr. Larry kept the machine, the whatever, going. And if he said no, it was closed before night.
Where was Dr. Leonard located?
His office was up.
North Broadway.
His office.
On the left-hand side, go ahead.
It's where Witt is now.
Oh, okay.
But also, he was Commissioner of Public Safety.
Police, Jim Larry, sheriffs.
That's
sheriffs.
Sheriffs and the police, that's.
They ran Saratoga. One of them wouldn't get paid off, they shut down Arrowhead.
And they never, but they, this new book out, have you seen it? The Burning of Piping Rock?
No.
No.
Don't read it, it's horrid.
Thank you.
It's just an awful book. But anyway, in there, he tells things like, Mr. Larry went to the base of the back fence to meet the gamblers to get paid off. Mr. Larry never went near a gambler. He didn't gamble, he didn't drink, he didn't smoke. He drank wine, and when he went to Newman's on Sunday night with his lady friend, he took the wine with him. That's the most of Mr. Larry's going out. It's a whole different era, and Mr. Larry, if he got paid off, which we assume he did, they brought it to him. He never went to get it.
That's the kind of lady I want in my office.
What did he say?
The kind of lady he wants in his office.
Anyway, you didn't have to be told those things. You just had to be there. If you had your eyes open, you knew. But then there were people on the corners who are still telling stories that they haven't a clue.
How about Doc Ferrone? Was he?
Well, I liked him.
Yeah.
He was I liked him. He was a nice, very nice man to me, but he was what everybody says he was. I worked or lived in the apartment of his sister, and she ran his office. And when she died, he died because he couldn't get along without her. No question. I don't care what anyone.
Well, she's a beautiful lady.
Mary.
His.
You mean his wife?
Yeah.
Oh, his wife.
His wife.
Margaret.
How about Marcella? Sad. He had so many sad things. It was like, he got up one night. Excuse me for interrupting, but Marcella had been out with a friend of hers.
He's talking about
Dr.
Leonard's wife.
She did it. Yeah. Oh.
That's Dr. Leonard's wife.
Dr. Leonard.
Oh, Dr. Ferrone's wife was.
Oh, Dr. Ferrone, excuse me.
She was a nice lady.
I didn't know her.
He didn't take any of that whole. His kids didn't know any of that.
Was he actually a doctor? Was Dr.
No.
It was a nickname. Dublin was full of nicknames.
Minnie, tell the story about the coal. There's a lack of coal in the town.
Who?
There was a lack of coal, heating coal.
Oh, yeah. They used
and to, doctor, what did doctor have?
Well, they used to make the train and take it off.
Yeah, that's what he
did. I don't know.
We get Dr. Rowan get credit for that.
I don't know who was it, which doctor it was, but somebody used to take the coal off the trains as they went through.
I do not agree with him. But on the voting machine, there's a green curtain, you know. Was it Dr. Ferrone or Dr. Leonard? They shine it a little bit. So they knew how that person voted. So that they'd be in the office.
That.
It makes a good story.
You know? But if you were involved, you voted the way they wanted you to.
Yeah.
I remember one time, Mr. Larry, the only time he ever said anything about voting. Because if you worked in there, you assumedly knew. I mean, I'm sure my mother was an Irish Catholic Democrat, but I never was, because I worked for Mr. Larry. But one day he said to me, when I was taking dictation from him, he said, I hope you're not going to vote for that drunk. And I said, Mary, I guess I was fresh, but I said, I didn't vote to him when he got in there. I should have said, would you put him in there?
Were they friends? Were Mr. Leary and Doc Leonard friends?
Doc Leonard, yes, people don't think that.
Back stairway, huh?
But it's interesting that you ask that, because I'll never forget when Mrs. Leonard called or died, Mr. Larry was the first one I mentioned to call, and I put the call through. They were friends. People didn't know that or think that. and I never saw Doc in the office, but we had a back stairway, and I don't doubt he was in there.
Where was your office?
City Hall.
Oh,
upstairs.
Were you in City Hall?
Our office was the whole, Debbie, would you shake this? I can't get it to shake. I have dry mouth. The whole back of City Hall was courtroom many, many years ago. But then in our time, when Mr. Leary left the...
First floor, wasn't it?
Oh.
First floor?
He was on the first, he was in the first floor in Mr. Brackett's office. And in 1910, he left. He and Mr. Fullerton and the best secretary in the office left. And they moved across the hall where Carousel later was. And they were there, I shouldn't have said 10 because I don't know, but in 1910, they moved downstairs, the three of them. And from then on, he had all the best lawyers in the area as they came out. Jim Carroll, John Doyle, Jim Heffernan, Jay Hurley from Glenswell, all the best lawyers, all Jim Carroll and Amy Ott was also in there. All of them went through our office. And then Mike went in 38, 9 when I did. He went in the summer of 38, passed the bar in 39, passed the bar whenever he took it, August or so, and stayed there until he left in 60. And by that time, John Lynch had been there, Bud Lynch had been there, Bud Keehan, they were all in there. And they all, several of them went out to be judges.
Now, to correct me if I'm wrong, but the Swedes were from Schenectady, Democrats.
Originally, no.
And he was a Mason, and when they came to Saratoga, Mike said he graduated from law school, I want to work for Mr. Leary. And his dad said, no, you got to be a Republican if you go to work. Well, anyway, Mike went down and saw Mr. But he went down and became a Republican. Then he went to see Mr. Leary, and Mr. Leary said, do you want to work here? No, Mike said, I'll work. You don't have to give me a debt. Just give me a place somewhere. I just to work in here. Because Mike said he learned more from Mr. Leary than ever he did at law school. And then Leary looked at, well, I knew your dad is a Mason. You're all Democrat. Mike said, no. So Leary pulls the book down and looks, Mike is a Republican. Okay, Leary, that's how we get hired. That's what Mike told me.
I don't know. Most of that I know, but his father was a Shay. His mother was a Shay, and they lived in Saratoga. But Mr. Sweeney went to Schenectady to work as a Mason, and that's where Mike was born. I never let him forget it. And then when he was, I think, 9, his mother died. He came back to Saratoga, and the family, Mr. Sweeney's sister, and a couple of the Shays, wanted to split the kids up. And Mr. Sweeney said, no way, I'm bringing my own kids up. He had 5 kids, and he brought them up. His sister lived across the street, and she took them in a week at a time or something. And she helped the oldest one, John, go to law school. He became a doctor. And I don't think Mike had much help going to law school, but they all went. And Mr. Sweeney was a Mason. He helped build the post office, mm-hmm. which opened in 1910. And
Mash, can we just a little sidelight there? Mike told me one time, he and his brother, gee, Dad is an awfully slow reader. Why is that? Well, he's got the paper, it looks like it's all the way. He's got the racing form. And don't you think that Mike, like the horses, he had a box at the clubhouse for 43 years, and Minnie and I would be up there as guests quite often. How about the time when it was St. Patrick's Day? And Mike probably, you know that probably, Mike came in with the green necktie on, and Leary looked at him. What are you wearing that for? Oh, it's St. Patrick's Day. He said, listen, this is the green subject cost. Big love, Joe.
I don't know that. I'll tell you, he did say something once to Mike. Mike had a beautiful ring with a diamond in it, which had been his father's or mother's, I don't know. And I, Mr. Lair said something about that, and I never saw it again.
How about, you know, Larry would say, go down and get a car. Down at the, down at Lake Avenue, you know, and you get a Cadillac. And they knew exactly what Larry was like to have. One time, I got to know Uncle Jim pretty well. Through Jim. Through Mike, too. One time I was up there, and as I was leaving, he said, is that your car out there? And I said, yeah. I had always had black cars. I read up to today, I got a black car. He said, I like black cars. That's what I had. So I get along pretty good with Jim. But, you know, he's another one.
You know what he had?
And it's tough.
But when I used to ride with him to Schenectady, he had a cat in a Cadillac. But it was a special build. And it was like, it was kind of like the trucks, the seat across the front, but the back was just place's door. And you could pull two seats down. Because he always, the first thing he did was put his duffel bag in there. But that's the only car I ever remember having. But he had black ones probably before me. I don't know what he had.
Is it true, Minnie, that he owned half of Saratoga and Dr. Leonard? Dr. Farone.
Well, Dr. Farone, and he owned it all together.
How about Jim, though? He had quite a bit.
Mr. Leary owned most
Union of Union Avenue?
Union Avenue, Clement Avenue, North Broadway, and many lower Broadway and side streets. You could mention something, and I could tell you how much rent they paid.
Minnie, what would you put the value of
that
he had?
Well, I don't know. They say she got $4 million and she left it to the Pope. I don't know that. We were gone. We had left there. We were not privy to the end. They didn't tell us anything. Or if they did, they didn't tell me.
And where was Doc Farone's area? Was he
his
on
office, the east side? His place was a plumbing shop on
Putnam Street.
Putnam Street, and you couldn't find your way in. It was such a mess. But his sister, Mary Flavia, I lived in her house upstairs, and I'd go down to chat with Mary, and her sister would be cooking in the kitchen always, and Mary would get up, we'd sit there, and the dining room table was a big table like that, and it was packed. Everything that was in there was on it. They didn't eat it there, right, in the kitchen. And the phone would ring, and she would go over there and bring the phone over to here, and Doc would talk to her and ask her things, and she would write. She knew everything that was going on in that place. And I seriously have always felt that he just didn't know what to do when she died. And he died very soon afterwards. And then they started squandering, stealing, taking, whatever.
How about Frenchie Farone?
Well, he was a lawyer, and he married, I think, a Skidmore girl, and ended up in Arizona and became assistant or whatever to the governor.
Clever guy.
Yeah,
Frenchie Farone.
I think he left because, I don't know this, but it just seemed if he stayed in Saratoga, he was going to be Doc's lawyer. That's all. So he left very, well.
Clever guy.
Probably
Frenchie Farone. Clever.
Probably when he got married.
How did Doc Farone? How did Doc Farone get the name Doc? I thought it was Doc.
I don't know. His name was Alphonse, wasn't it?
Alfred?
According to the DeAndre family, because he was so short, they called him Doc.
Well, she was his sister.
He got conceived as Dr. Doc.
Well, she was, Mrs. DeAndre was his sister.
I know that. That's where I heard the Doc came from.
And I don't know.
Got changed to Doc.
Yeah.
Because he was not a doctor, obviously.
Yeah, no.
One of the most interesting people.
He was a very pleasant, nice looking guy, too.
No matter what you. Well, go ahead. I must be wandering away. I was going talking about Dr. Leonard. You know, he did so much for people. He actually had interest in people. And my parents lived out, had a house on Church Street, and there used to be a, Dakes had a milk processing, and the odor from KC is just like bodies rotting. Awful, it was awful. And my mother called the health director that he nothing was done. And it was really awful bad. So she called Dr. Leonard. Dr. Leonard came out, went over and talked with the people, and there were no more. And then they used to run the stuff down to another field or something to let it dry out or something. But that just that was a, I didn't pay much attention to this stuff because I wasn't way, I was busy, busy, busy.
And as far as Mr. Larry probably didn't care too much about people, but he did that time. But he would, I know personally two people who he had their eyes operated on. He had a thing about that. And one of them.
Cross-eyed. Did you have a secretary that was cross-eyed?
Well, she wasn't his secretary, but yes. But first, before that, he was a, he'd park his car back at the Algonquin, and he'd walk down to work. And he wandered around and talked to everybody. And he used to stop little kids and ask them which hand they wanted, or sometimes this way. And they're always amazed him when they took the nickel instead of the dime. He used to talk about that. But also, there's a fellow, he's still in town, he's a year older than me, and he told me himself that he had a bad eye, very bad, and Mr. Leary saw him one day, he was selling papers, he was Italian, is Italian, and he said, he wanted to know my name. He says, I want you to go home and tell your mother and father I want to take care of that eye. And I don't know, ultimately he went to Dr. Goodfellow and had his eye straightened. Now I know that man, and there's a girl that worked in the office, and when she got out of high school, she was 10 years younger, 20 years younger than me, I used to walk back and forth to work with her, and her eye was crossed, and right after she got the job, she said one day, first thing I got to do was save enough money to get my eye fixed. So I told Mike, and he told Mr. Larry, and Mr. Larry said, get it fixed, period. And Mike called the girl's mother, who she was a telephone operator, she didn't have anything, and his father wasn't around. And she said, oh, I can't let him do that. And I remember Mike saying to her, Irma, it's like taking $5 out of your pocket, let him. And he did, and her eye, coincidentally, she's now blind, but she had a very straight eye for a long, long time.
Did Jim Leary go to the racetrack very often?
Sure.
He had a box.
He had a box. Mr. Fullerton had a box, too. Mike never had a box until he got to be a judge.
Mr. Fullerton was the brains, and Mike always said, Jill, if they were working on a case, Fullerton would know all about the background, the law, and then, of course,
he would take the law. He'd take
clever man.
He'd get all the. He couldn't go into courtroom. He couldn't.
He
didn't
couldn't
have the presence to.
Larry did that part.
We should be talking about Saratoga instead of Larry Fullerton. But anyway, Mr. Fullerton would go in with Mr. Larry. They'd hash the whole thing over with whatever lawyer was handling it. And Mr. Fullerton would come to the door and he'd scream, get me 288 New York. And by the time you walked that hallway, he would say, page 88. He knew he had a photographic mind, there's no question. And Mr. Larry knew what to do with it. They were a good partnership.
Whatever happened to Mr. Fullerton's son, Junior?
Oh. I don't know.
He had a, I remember driving
Walter.
A convertible with the money and all. This guy, they had money. They just looked at him in the distance.
He got married and moved to Florida. That's what he did. That's all I remember about he was in.
And that's a beautiful house they had on
43 Fifth.
What is still a beautiful house. Almost as good looking as what I have, Jamel Mansion. How do you feel about Jamel Mansion? What would you say about Jamel, Liza Jamel, who was a big person in Saratoga way before our time? What's your history?
She was a smart lady.
Yeah. Go ahead. Is she smiling?
She had five husbands.
Five husbands? How do you know that?
I because that's in my book.
Yeah, but I've been in New York in the West Side Museum.
She had a place in New York, and she married Aaron.
Rogers, Will Rogers' house, yeah.
She married Aaron Burr.
Stephen, who was the shipping magnate in New York City. He had 14 ships trading with Spain and France.
But you lived in her house, you know more about her. She owned most of the land in Saratoga in those years, 1880s, from her house out to St. Clements. Did you know that? I have a map showing every lot, and every lot on my map is marked.
That's right.
How much he saw it in the city historian's office. I know that. I was told. But every lot on it, it tells how much they got for it.
Oh my goodness.
And I was lucky enough to get that in the house one time.
And I heard one time that she owned the Ripon Dam Hotel too.
Well, they did like her on Broadway.
You mentioned her name and said, oh, she's nothing. No good. She's a bad thing. But she was in business. Now when he was on Europe, she'd be down, they owned property at Liberty Street in Manhattan. And she'd be down there collecting rents. And she would foreclose mortgages. The woman never did that. She's a bad lady. But she was way ahead of her time. I'm always defending Madame Jamel. Which, you know, I get a bad reputation from my environment, but I think she was a good lady.
Did you guys, as you were growing up, and did most of your friends work at the track? And did you go to the track
a lot? Mike worked at the track when he was a kid.
He was a dipper boy.
Who was a dipper boy?
Dipper, my boss.
No kidding.
He wanted to be a jockey, but he got too tall. He used to tell that all the time. I've heard these stories a thousand times. They're interesting, and I hear them again, but he was a dipper boy, and he also was an usher in the Palace Theater.
Tell him what he used to do was in between times of standing on the street talking about license plate numbers or something.
What?
Talking about that, that's probably between Mike and I guess you didn't get that. Anyway, go ahead. He was at the Palace Theater, right where Washington Street comes in.
Yeah.
And
Division Street.
He enjoyed that.
He did, and he worked for a very short time. Well, he did work for him, but Mr. Slade was his idol.
Yeah.
And Mr. Slade had an office up over the Palace Theater. Anyway, it was a great time. What do you know about the racetrack? The first time I remember the racetrack, my uncle was a policeman, Roy Clark, for many years. And
what was his name?
Roy.
Oh, yeah.
Roy. And he was a motorcycle cop. And my father...
I think he gave me a ticket one time.
Probably. My father was a suburb cop sometimes. I have pictures, both of them in it. It happened to be a picture of all the cops. And my uncle, I was living with my Uncle Roy after my grandmother died. And on East Avenue, and my father would come at about 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning and take us up to the track to watch them exercise. That's the first time I ever went to the track. And then after that, I started on my 18th birthday, and I went every year since, including this year.
You did good for you. You made me.
I went. My nieces got me a wheelchair because we didn't have a seat, and we parked the seat. And the first person we met was from Skidmore, and they had the box. And she says, "Well, you don't have to sit here. You can sit in our box." So during the day, one of my nieces got the bugler.
Sam.
And he came up and bugled happy birthday to me.
And last year they named a race for you.
Well, yes, dear, they have a race name for me. That was exciting. I don't know how they did that, but I don't
know. Did Mike, or did Uncle Jim bet on horses?
No, no. Mike didn't either.
No, beneath the dignity. So one time, we on the backside, when Mike and I were sitting pretty back there, a lot of action. It's busy, but quiet. You're working on these horses, you know, but the most interesting. Mike said, and I agree with him, it was just better than the front side, you know. But anyway, so we met a lot of trainers. Lucian Lauren, the trainer secretary, got to know him real well. And we'd have a cup of coffee back there, you know. Mike and I used to like to sit back there and talk with all these people. You know. You get the real feel for racing back there. And it was very, very interesting. So one time, I'm walking by Mike's box, and he's got other judges with him. Oh, there's always room for one more. Come on in. So I said, great, you always have a place to sit. Two tickets, one for Mike and one for myself. So I came back to the box. Hey, Mike, guess who we saw? I just saw Lucian Lord. Oh, yeah, how is he doing? Oh, he just got inducted in the Hall of Fame in Canada. And here's why he's telling me that this Reba is going to win this race. And here's our ticket for you and here's for me. You know what he did? He pushed it over to one side so that he wouldn't be associated.
He never got
it.
No. And then he'd say to me, well, why didn't you come up? I had the winner. In other words, somebody had given him the winner. He didn't bet it. B would bet, but he wouldn't.
Yeah, I didn't.
$2, no more. Anyway, what else you want to know?
How about the story when he was young? Maybe it's best we don't talk about that. About Mike Sweeney when he was a young boy.
What about him? I didn't know him then.
Well, I'm not, if you didn't know, I'm not going to discuss this. Because Mike Sweeney was one of my best friends, class of 1933. And one time, I was taking chemistry because I'm getting ready for something. Maybe I didn't know what I was going to do, but anyway. And behind me, he's taking chemistry too. But he's got the racing part. He's always into racing. That's enough of that.
During the war, was there a lot of rationing and things going on? Did they have like blackout curtains?
I wasn't around much.
And I had friends who used to, I never did it. We used to go to the armory and up at the top of the armory, and what did they do up there?
They looked for airplanes up there. Now, I've often wondered, because I've been up in the tower all the time, do you know if they actually went up onto the roof, or did they just stand down on the next level and you can look through the windows like all around?
Well, I always thought they went to the top, but I never went.
Okay.
The only thing I remember about the armory is we went roller skating there.
They oh, really?
Roller skating.
They played basketball there too.
It was a wonderful, all through the 30s. Huh. Everybody ended up roller skating and died. Some of us good, some of us not so good. Well, it was quite a life.
Beautiful, Bill. We're fortunate to have that library and museum. Mm-hmm. I think because it's really good looking building.
How about Convention Hall? What was that like?
Wonderful.
Oh.
It was a big basketball game there. Basketball.
They played basketball. My son was basketball because he was tall too.
Yeah, but that's like.
And there's one place on the floor where it was soft. And of course, he knew that space was. And the other team didn't know about that soft place there, because you had to be careful. You get there, the ball would only go one way or another, you know. But it was old, and it finally burned down.
The Harlem Globetrotters. That's in my new book.
Harlem Globetrotters.
I just read about that. 1927, some band in Chicago started the Harlem Globetrotters because they couldn't play with the white boys. And they became famous. Do any of you remember them?
Oh, yeah.
And they brought them to Saratoga. Jim Carroll had the franchise for the team, Saratoga team, and they brought them to Saratoga many times. And boy, a Bill Hall. Great, it was a great place. It was built in 1893, burned in 1964, sadly.
Was there a car dealer on the end of Convention Hall, possibly?
There was a Ross Ketchum car dealer.
So I think my dad drove cars out when the building was burning.
I have pictures of the inside of Ross Ketchum's. They used to apparently store cars there for people in the winter. I've got some great pictures that must have come from a mechanic, not your father, maybe your father.
Well, did Ketchum live on Union Avenue?
I think Ketchum lived on the...
So there was a Jimmy Ketchum was in school when I was there.
I knew Mrs. Ross.
Red Gaffney.
Yeah, I knew Mrs. Ross, but then the other thing that was House of Panza was the next thing on the block, that's all of them.
Do you think there was much crime in Saratoga during August?
Well, I'm sure, but not like there could have been. That's another thing. It was controlled.
Controlled.
It was controlled.
Tickets and the rest were all controlled.
I mean, the gamblers were here for the month, and they thought they ran the show, if they put the money up, of course. And
what about organized crime?
Well, I don't know. I don't know enough about it to know whether they were organized, but there was plenty of crime in New York and Chicago. Mm-hmm.
Meyer Lansky?
Well, he was a character, yeah.
The only time he went to jail was when he was
Saratoga. In Saratoga. And he sent the sheriff's office, one of the guys, the sheriff, said, he went to Mike, Meyer Lansky wants to see you. This is in a book, it's true. I know it's true. And Mike says, well, you have to see me for a lawyer. He don't need me for a lawyer. He don't, you know. So Mike went down, and Gerard King was in the next cell.
He had the restroom.
And Mike went in, and Lansky says to him, I hear you could get me some meals. You know, get me some good meals. And Gerard, of course, had already told him he'd get the meals, but he didn't have the push to get them. So Mike spoke to the sheriff, and they had good meals from them. All the while, he wasn't there. I don't think he was there more than a week or so, a week maybe. But it's the only time he ever went to jail. Probably the nicest jail he could find.
There's a book. Did you have his book, The Little Man?
Yeah.
Meyer Lansky. Clever man.
It's a good one.
Costello and all those.
It's a good one.
Gangsters.
They were probably, Vic Urquhart was one of the nicest men I ever knew. And he was a gambler, so that didn't bother us. His daughter, one of his stepdaughters, and I were great friends, and we'd go up to the raceway, and she'd say, come on, we're going to bet this. We were betting off his bets. We didn't know what we were doing.
Where was he located for his game?
A railroad place up over the bus terminal.
Where?
Up over the bus station on the corner of Division and Railroad Place.
Okay.
And Harold Fishbaugh, and he had a gambling joint up there. I never was up there. And there was a wooden Indian to show you where the door was. What else do you need to know about gambling?
Yeah,
I'm not a gambler.
Wooden Indian, I can remember that.
There was one on Church Street.
I was a big guy, though.
There was a lot on Church Street, too.
Now, what caused all these gambling casinos to just disappear?
Well, Kefauver.
Yeah.
A Saratoga man's wife got mad and turned them all in.
And they're going to get Jim Larry.
They thought, well, they'll get to the top. They'll get Mr. Larry. And it took them 5 years to have him acquitted.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Did he actually go on trial?
Yes. Just recently, a young lady here in town called me, and I knew her father. He worked at our Schenectady office. And she's married, lives here now. And she says, I've got some papers I want to show you. And she brought me a wad of papers about that thick. And they were all the things that her father knew about in the investigation. And they were subpoenas. I was subpoenaed myself. And he must have been subpoenaed 100 times. And every time he or anybody went to the grand jury, when they came out, or anybody connected with us, and when they come out, they'd have to tell what happened, dictate it to one of us. And there's some of the papers, many of them, are him dictating to different ones of the secretaries. And there's one of Mike dictating to me, and a lot of them, a couple of Mr. Larry. And they all tell you exactly what went on in the grand jury room. And
tell them about the time when Larry is being fined. A certain amount of money had to be turned over. So Larry turns and Mike said, hey.
Oh,
so
that happened
so
in
Mike
the courtroom.
Took a big roll.
So anyway, that I'll tell you in a minute. So these papers are all, they're no good to anybody. But I tease. So I spent a couple of weeks while I've been sick. I've had some problems. And putting them together in proper order in plastic pages and in books. So now she's coming next Monday and we're going to decide what to do with them. I hope she offers them to me. But anyway, I want to tell you about my subpoena. I was subpoenaed because I was on the front desk in the office toward the later. And Mike had an office over there, and I was here. And I knew several of the troopers. We used to all hang around Pine Inn, and the troopers all come in there. We used to have so much fun with them. So one day, one of the troopers came in. They used to come in and serve with everybody, you know. And one day, one of them came in, and he said, gee, Ben, I hate to tell you, but this one's for you. So he served me with the subpoena, and I had two of them. I don't remember going the second time, but I know I went. And they asked me, it was all about the bank stock. And the bank, they tried to get Mr. Larry on many things. And one, the main thing they ultimately tried was that he owned the bank. And he said he didn't. This man, Herb Stone, owned it. Well, Herb Stone was a lackey. He didn't own the time of day. but he owned the bank, which he did. So the lawyer...
Mike was the president.
Mike was, no, not by, yeah, by that time he was. So the Saratoga National Bank. So the lawyer says to me, he had a sheet of paper a little longer than your pads there, and it was smooth. And it was obviously bank stock. And he said to me, did you ever see this before? And I said, no. Well, I see it. And he said, so then he stood there for a few minutes, and I kept looking at Mike. And Mike would look at me in the courtroom. And I said, because nobody told me what to say. I mean, what could I say?
You knew what you're supposed to say.
Well, I don't think they thought I knew anything, which I didn't. So he says to me, well, have you ever seen it before? And I said, no. So a couple of minutes later, he said, well, was it ever in the Blackmer box? Was that where it was kept? And I said, no. And he said, well, if you've never seen it before, how do you know that? I said, because it wouldn't fit. Well, it was this long bag stock, fresh, never been folded, and the blank box was that wide. And to get it in, you'd have had to fold it four ways. So I knew it was. Well, he couldn't understand that. And then another thing he asked me, which kills me to this day, he said, who draws the checks? And I said, I do. He says, well, who signs them? And I said, Mr. Fuller, or Mr. Lair, if he has to. And he said, well, what about petty cash? I said, we don't have any. Now, here's an office that took in thousands of dollars of rent at Mr. Larry's, but it was our office. And I said, we don't have a petty cash. He says, what do you mean you don't have petty cash? He said, where do you buy your, how do you buy your stamps? And I said, well, I draw a check, and Mr. Fullerton signs it, and I go to the post, or I get them. And he says, and then, well, what do you do? He says, I said, well, the Scoutable postmaster brings them in. I call him, ask him for them, and he brings them in, and I give him the check. He said, the Scoutable postmaster. Well, apparently, I didn't know this before, but apparently in those days, you had to, somebody political got you in as a postmaster. And Mr. Larry got that job from that man. I can't remember his name. And so everyone, when I need stamps, this is when I first worked there, you had to call Schuylerville and tell them what you want, and they brought this. The post office was across the street. We got them from Schuylerville. Well, nobody in that courtroom believed that, I'm sure. But it's what happened. And, anyway, but there were so many things that we just didn't do like everybody else because they worked and they'd done them all their lives, you know. But I remember those two things. But Mike, what I wanted to see from Mike where he wanted me, the stock to be, but he would look at me. So I knew it wasn't where he asked anyway, so I proved that. But anyway, Mr. Larry was, how could you get a jury in Saratoga County? To put Mr. Larry in jail. And they didn't put Doc Leonard in jail because he was too old.
They wanted to.
But he was
the Commissioner of Public Safety. And all this that's going on is really pretty obvious now. So they forced him to resign. But then at the next election, they voted him back in again.
His deputy,
were all for Dr. Leonard.
Did you know his deputy was Bill Ford's father?
No, I didn't know that.
And did you know Bill Ford's mother was his sister?
I didn't know that either.
See, I talked to you. I told you something. You know.
Did you used to go to the lake houses? Did you ever go?
Well, I went to Riley's once when it was reopened. They had a racetrack party there. I was invited to. But the Calumet party was for them. And I went to Newman's, and I went to Meadowbrook, but I was never in the others.
Arrowhead?
I was too young.
Arrowhead?
No, Arrowhead. No.
Did you ever get there?
No.
Well, I was invited there one time.
But you were older.
Did you? Pardon?
You were older.
Older, right?
Older than me.
Well, I was a guard at the pool. And Marshall Cassidy, who established Integrity in Racing, Alfred Vandenberg admitted that Marshall Cassidy established Integrity in that. But it was really, really bad. Anyway, he had a daughter, Marcelia, and she used to be down at the pool quite a bit. Now, when you're a guard at the pool, then you have Bing Crosby, Sophie Tucker, Hal Jolson, and all these entertaining people around you. So then the waiters from the Gideon would be down there at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and so I got to know them real well. Why don't you come on up and have dinner with us sometime? Okay. So Skippy was there, and I said, would you have dinner with me? Oh yeah, sure, fine. And she's driving a Cadillac convertible, and so I guess she probably picked me up because I didn't have a car at the time. And we'd go to the Gideon Putnam, go in to the dining room. And the Gideon Putnam, if you were from Saratoga, it didn't let you in. No locals. But here I am with Skippy Cassidy, who would go in and have a dinner, beautiful dinner, really, really nice, no check. The waiters didn't, so I had never had to pay for that, because I was very important. They paid me 50 cents an hour at the Gideon.
What were you, a night watchman? Or a night?
I was a guard.
Oh, my husband, Fred, was a night auditor at the Gideon. In other words, you went in and did the books for the night.
Well, he probably got paid more.
Well, he did. He was also there for the Saratoga Inn. But I was going to tell you something else about the nightclubs. You know, the gambling was not in, it was always attached, another building. And then I'll tell you a story about Interlaken, which is where Lockfellas is. Well, there was the big barn that he's got made into it. Well, there was that beautiful big old barn. It was just an old barn. And it was called Interlaken. And it was a after-hour, big-time gamblers gambling joint. Peanut butter, peanut chunks on the floor, just, you know, just a nothing. And there's all kinds of stories, like Chowder Duell tells a story, had told a story about there were rafters where the gunmen were up around the top. Well, that never happened. I mean, I was never there, but let me tell you. Remigio Pavoy's father was on the edge of all that gambling. He ran for mayor once, too, but he didn't win. But anyway, one day he came home and he said to Remigio and her mother, I want you to get dressed up, and when I come back, I want you to come out to the club tonight because it's the end. It's closing tonight. This is it. In other words, come out and see it, see what it, well, Remigio's mother wanted no part of it, but Remigio did, of course. So she probably wasn't more than 14, 15, if that. So she gets dressed up and he said, now, I want you to come, I'll send the car for you, and I want you to come out, and I want you to stay out of the way, and keep your mouth shut. That was a little tough for Remigio. So she went, and she told me this herself. She said, no cops, no guns. There might have been people around the parking lot who had guns, but there was none of that up there. And she said she was there, and she watched the whole episode the last night. But it was just big time gambling for the
Arrowhead.
And the other place that was big time for late night was Cherry's on Union Avenue, which was a bar before it became all these other bars.
Whereabouts was that?
Well, it's still there. It was Bruno's.
Oh, okay.
That was that little house is where Mr. Cherry brought up his 8 kids. And the bar next to it was a restaurant. And he ran it, and then his kids, as they came along, did. But he had big time gambling in the back. That's where people stopped on the way home from wherever. I've been in there many times, but not when it was like that. You know, it continued until whoever bought it. I forgot who had it first.
Speaking of nightclubs, Arrowhead was really something. I mean, Sir Tony did. And Bentley's and Mrs. Dodge Sloan and all those people were there. And of course, Skippy said, would you like to go? It was the year that 1941, when Worthaway won the Kentucky Derby, came to Saratoga, and won the Travers. That's never been done before. And I've been invited by Sheila or Skippy to go to the Arrowhead. So I dress up pretty, got my new necktie on and all dressed up. And she picked me up, we went for the beautiful story on there. All these big crowds. During the intermission, some big famous band was playing. During the intermission, Bing Crosby got me playing the drums and singing. Everybody loved that time. But these were all top people. And so I was walking along with Skippy, and one of the top people, I forgot what his name was now, and she, he was came along, and she introduced me, you know, Leo Hoge. And he looked over at me, and looked at me, you can do better than that. Who is this guy? I said, you know, when you're young, I don't have a key, you know, but he's telling me, you can do better than that. And who is he thinking? I unfortunately didn't punch him, but I felt like giving me a punch.
You know, Bing Crosby was here every year, and I don't know anything about his activity at the track, but he always Bing Crosby.
Oh, yeah.
He had a house on Madison Street one year. I have a picture up in front of the house. And he used to come to St. Clements to the bazaar. And, oh, not him, not just him, but Sophie Tucker and all of them. But they used to come up and sing. So we all saw him. We stand as close as we could get. It was a nice time. Those were the 30s.
You know what I've always wondered, and you two would be the perfect people to ask. Remember the clock tower that used to be on top of City Hall?
No, they took it down.
Any idea what happened to that, or where?
No.
I took a picture of it.
It was during the WPA that they took it down.
Yeah.
Speaking of the WPA, you know the paintings in the City Hall and the post office?
Yeah.
Well, they're gorgeous. I mean, they're just what they are. And I read just recently, and I was telling this to someone, and they say they already know that. And I hope somebody does, but they're worth millions.
Wow.
I don't know whether it was 1 million or two, but it was discussed in an antique trade paper that I had. And I just recently, too. And I said that to someone, and they said, well, I think Kettlewell has also told them that they what they were worth. But I hope they, because we saved them once. God knows what they would have done with them. I'd have had them on my back porch if I cared. but I didn't get them. I have one, though. I have a wonderful one of the railroad station, which is definitely, and I know it now, I found that out recently, done by a WPA artist. And it was in a magazine, and it was about that big, and it was a glossy magazine, and it was for sale in New York. And I called and tried to buy it because it was our railroad station, and it showed Dick Urquhart's building too. And so I called, and he said, oh, I sold it. And stupidly, I said to him, do you know where it is? And he said, no. And I said, well, Saratoga. He said, can you prove that? I said, sure. So I sent him a postcard of it, and similar. And then I said to him, will you see if they'll sell it to me? Well, no way could I buy it then. They just wouldn't sell it. So I kept it for about 20 years, and I had a friend come in the house who is an artist, a classmate of mine. And I said to her, Betty, could you paint this for me? She said, sure. So I have it.
Nice.
I have it, and it's signed by her. And recently, I checked the ad. I've still got the ad, and checked the artist, and he was a WPA artist, but he became famous afterwards. So that's one of my favorite pictures.
When I was a junior in high school, I got a job. Everybody said, work in Saratoga. And I got a job as a bellhop in the damn hotel. George Bolster was the night clerk, and I'm the bellhop at night. And I remember in the lobby, there was a frame thing, the Queen's Charter. This property is the Queen's Charter. And I often wonder whatever happened to that.
What did it say?
The Queen's Charter. This property where the Ripon Dam Hotel is Queen's property. I was from England, owned that property at one time. Now, I wonder if...
I've never seen it.
Sophie or Flanagan must have had it.
Well, Bill Flanagan. You could go in the cellar, it might still be there.
Well, I don't think I'm going to get it.
You'd be amazed. I noticed I had one in the cellar not long ago. It was pretty good.
Well, you know, there's so much history in Saratoga. Saratoga was so popular. Everybody came here, including... Stonewall Jackson.
Did you hear anything you really wanted?
Oh, yes, definitely.
Great.
Yeah.
I don't know.
The Roosevelt Baths turned into a veterans hospital?
That's recent.
1940? And it says that it was open, operated from 43 to 51.
1 year before Pearl Harbor.
43 to 44.
43 to 51, and then it was moved to Albany.
Yeah.
Dr. Walter McClellan became the medical director.
You know,
medical director. I'll never forget that. When I'm a guard, excuse me for interrupting you, but to bring you back to memory, I'm a guard at the pool, and it's really pretty well bred. People don't run around and shout, and no food near the pool. Bill Brandon and I were guards, and we, you know, and when we came on duty, we cleaned all the pool, the back of it, and then was 5% sort of hypochlorite around the city area, so that no one had no bacteria. Everybody had to have a soap shower before they came in, and then come through a foot bath. And we really had to do man that place, and we blew our whistle, really cutting down on people doing all that. So it was, and then. Take a swim, and we're sitting there, and they mentioned flowers all around, you know, and only classical music was being played. They didn't do anything but classical music. But we're sitting there, and the sun is shining, the flowers, came and built it. Can you imagine they're paying us to work here? Crying. This is heaven, because, you know, we have to. You meet so many people there. Ben Crosby sitting telling us about a movie they're making on Hollywood now, and he's sitting there. We're supposed to be on some island in the Pacific, and he said to make the reflection of the waves. There's a pan of water here, and they're stirring it to make the waves on my face. We almost broke out laughing. You know? Things like
you
that.
You know, we're very lucky with that, Doc, because we have a group down there now that will give their lives if you do anything bad to that pool. They're taking such good care of it. And it's just as popular as it was then. I've never been there. I don't see it.
People playing backgammon on the table, that's where you introduce the backgammon. And Sophie Tucker was this big. Maybe the big,
gorgeous hair.
And she come down and she walking down, going, "Oh, the water's rising." Now Jolson.
She was a nice lady.
And he gave Remy Dent, who they had been a doctor to, gave him $10 for taking care of him at the solarium. And it was the most interesting play. Great play in my life. Like Mike said, when you were a young guy, and then when I was at the Dam Hotel, that was an education because with the people, the gamblers and all that were there, you know. And at the end of the meet, I went down to see Mr. Flanagan to get paid. And he said, "How'd you make out, Leo?" "Oh," I said, "yeah, very well." So he gave me $12 for working for the month of August. Here I'm. When I take these guys up to their room,
they give you $100.
They gave me $5. This, you know, the Arrowhead car would pull up, open the back, guy with a submachine gun there like that. And then two guys would get out, one on the porch, one on the other end of the porch, and obviously with guns. Then the second car would pull up, and the guy would hop out with a package. He'd run up, go behind the counter with George, and they'd get out on the floor, count the money, then put it in our safe, so in the morning we'd take it up to the bay. You could do it at 4 o'clock in the morning. And then I've got all the racing papers for these guys. I take them up to the third floor, and I give them their papers, you know. They give me a $5 tip. $5 tip. And he's giving me $12 for He knew what it was
worth. $5 was probably the smallest one.
Whoa. Dr. Hoge, when the pool opened over by the Gideon,
yeah.
It was heated originally.
Yes.
Yeah,
I worked in 37
and 38.
And was it heated then? Do you remember it being heated?
They didn't make a big
reports from when they were rebuilding it, or trying to keep it a year or so ago, it was all heated.
Yeah.
And also the baths were heated, which people laugh at now because They say they put regular warm water in. Well, I've had a bath. Have you ever had a bath?
No.
Well, a few years ago, they had a big button that you put on. Have you had a bath today? Well, the judge's secretary is from the area, six of us. We used to go there and have a bath, and then we would win the bar. Whatever we earned or made out of the bath, we lost in the bar.
Quarter to 12.
Quarter to 12.
What's happened?
Quarter to 12.
That's good.
Quarter to 12.
Did you ever hear of Holocaust survivors coming from Germany for the baths after the war?
I remember a young boy in our class who came, and incidentally, he ultimately ended up in California, very involved in NASA, and still living, maybe a year or two younger than I. Several young people that I knew came and lived with relatives here in town. And of course, you knew the Jews came because you saw them, but I didn't know anything about them, except that's why they were here.
For the curing purposes.
They believed, I still believe in the waters. I very seldom pass the High Rock Avenue without stop for water. I don't care which one it is, they're all good. And that one on the end, the Red Spring, is very good for your eyes. I don't care what anybody says.
Well, when I was at the pool, there was a scientist from Europe who was staying there at the administration building doing research work on the mineral waters. And he loved to swim, so I got to know him real well, And he's always swimming there, And then eventually, he went to the West Coast, but anyways, checking in the waters, the purity of the waters, and there was a lot of research work done on that. And then McGovern was practicing it. And anyway, the state put a sign, if you drink more than one glass of this water, it's harmful to your health. Crying a lot, Malcolm called me, hey, we can't have that. Saratoga Springs is named after the water. And I've been drinking since I was in high school, riding a bicycle without to drink the water. And I really enjoy it too. So I called the Paul Bay and I said, Saratoga Springs, it should not use those signs. It's putting people off. Saratoga Springs depends on people to come here for that. A lot of them do anyway. So then I went back one time, a week or two later. They had taken the sign down, and that was just a directional sign now, which way here. So
why did they say the water was harmful?
Because it's got radium, which when you drink that water, it stays in your body for 1,000 years. It's got a half-life of 1,000 years. A radiation would have been feel over here.
Radium,
but I still drink the water. And then there's one down Hayes Well on the back end of the, there's a little pipe there. And I stood there one time and felt, when I have a cold, and I breathe these fumes in. Wow.
Yeah.
Radium 227. Burns. Wow. You don't want to take 227, man. I was telling my friends at the lab, I get together with those guys. Man, you drink some drink of the water. All it takes is one little peek and you had it.
Did you know that Dr. Oriana, old Dr. Oriana?
Oh, great man. No, I didn't know.
Did you know he worked with radium and used it? I have to tell you. I better not tell you.
Did he die with something?
Huh?
What did he die of?
I don't think I know. I don't know. I don't.
He worked with radium.
I knew the young one, but he had radium in his office.
No, thank you.
Was it Dr. Ant that did the water analyzation? Herbert Ant?
Yeah, Dr. Ant.
Oh, yeah, I got an analysis of all the mineral waters. Everything in. So if you want to know the details, but I don't talk about it.
And Dr. McCullough's papers are all in the library. He left all his papers to the library.
So one day at the pool, let me get back at the pool again. His daughter is running along. There's there's a drainage where the splash goes over on there. She was running along on that splashy area, and she slipped and fell. And when she hit, she knocked a couple teeth out. Oh, the doctor was calling, geez, that's good. He's the head man of the spa. He said, why did you call him, Tom? Foolishly, you know, young guy, I'm just a guard, that's all. I take orders. I was good for the Navy because taking orders. So I called Dr. McCall and I said, well, you know, your daughter had just taken a bad fall, and I think a couple of teeth are loose anyway, and we go. And oh, he said, and we got by, no lawsuits or anything else.
Oh, everybody didn't sue everybody in those days.
No, that's true.
Did the two of you have favorite springs? Was there certain springs
that
you
like? I just like them all.
You like them
and,
all?
And I still laugh about the fact that I had cousins who lived up around Gales Road, and they, to this day, if they come down, they make the worst faces. They're so boring. And I also, in my book, there's stories about back in the 1820s and 30s, people were making very good. In fact, they used to go to the spring every morning, and part of the fun of going to the spring was to watch people's reactions, which was horrid, but they drank it.
See, many of the Jewish people would be up here, you know, the Jewish hotels on Fifth Avenue and on Circular Street, too. It was amazing. But there was, used to be you know where this place was on South Broadway. They had a big sign, it was a hotel, said, no dogs or Jews allowed. Now, this was no dogs or Jews allowed. And even at the Gideon Putnam, Jews were not allowed there until we got a Jewish governor, Lehman or whatever.
Lehman.
Who was it?
Lehman.
Well,
changed that to let the Jews come.
Of course, I have one of the
local people couldn't go in there either.
I have one of the signs from the Russell that says Gentile management. I mean, there was no question. But there's a couple of good stories about that. A Skidmore professor wrote, I think it was Dr. Reeves wrote a good story about that. Seligman was the one.
How about Dr. Hyde?
Huh?
How about Dr. Hyde Skidmore? He's a chemist.
Well, I went to school with his daughter. That's all I know about Hyde.
And you know, speaking of gambling houses, I used to go to this Jolly White, and Jim Thone. On Fowler Street, you know, you go down from the road, it's on the right hand side.
And
always would be, Dr. Hyde would be in there, Professor Skidmore, always betting on the horses. He was originally from Texas, so he had an interest in horses, but it was kind of unusual to see something like that in the horse room. And Sonny Pompey Limpy again. He had crutches, and the board was up here with all the aqueduct and all the horse tracks. This guy was an artist, he printed the name so beautifully on there. And the other side is where you bet your bet. That's it. But it was interesting. And there would be people coming from New York who just sit in these rooms. Some it didn't go to the track, really. It's just a bet there at the horse room.
Tote boards were on chalkboards, right?
Chalkboard.
I have a chalkboard.
Yeah.
I have a chalkboard from McGurr's. I bought it from Mrs. McGurr, and I was buying Christmas ornaments. And she says, honey, what do you think of this thing? And I said, oh, I'll take one. She said, well, I got a lot of them. So I bought two. And this is in my new book. I shouldn't be telling you. And I got them home. On my way home, I stopped to visit a friend. And she says, oh, I'd like one. So I sold her one. $20, just what I paid for it. And two or three years ago, I've had mine on the wall ever since. Two or three years ago, she calls me up and she said, how would you like that chalkboard back? And I said, oh, sure. Don't you want it? She said, no. I said, how much? She says, $20. That's what I paid for it 20 years ago. And she brings it up, and she has, it's a completely erased. Mine has a race, the race and the figures from the horse room on it. And hers has been erased. Her kids played with it as a chalkboard all these years. So I gave the second one to my niece's husband because he liked mine. and he put his own grace on there.
Oh, wow.
And he's got it on his back porch, or the summertime anyway.
Now, what's the title of your new book?
You ready for this?
Uh-huh.
Collecting Saratoga, The Adventures of Minnie Bolster.
Oh, very nice.
Good, very nice.
It's fun. It's fun. It's been fun writing, and it's almost finished. It is finished as far as the fun things, but we're working on pictures.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have your, you have to have pictures.
Have you got a picture of Gideon Putnam's burial site?
The bar?
Gideon Putnam. No, the burial. Gideon Putnam, the founder of Saratoga.
No, but
his cemetery.
My next book is going to be about Gideon Putnam.
Yeah, that's.
I know. I just like to put this stuff down that I read. But anyway, it's a lot of fun.
Through the
and I
cemetery.
Had some really fun experiences.
When the Grand Jury was standing, I took that picture. So you get the Grand Jury, that's where he started, with his little inn there. And then he built the cemetery, and he was the first one to be buried there.
We have no picture of him, do we? We have no idea what he
was. No, it's a shame.
Yeah.
He was a good businessman.
A new book, I got a good idea for a book. I shouldn't say it. I'm going to try to do it. I have 5 scrapbooks from the Gideon Putnam from the day they dug the hole. It tells you everything. How they got the money, who worked on it, everything. And Eddie Sweeney was the first manager. And the scrapbooks had, if you went to the Gideon, your name would be in the paper that night. Everybody who went there. So all these articles are wonderful. And there's one whole page typed, single space, about Gideon. And I think it would be fun to write a book called, is that thing on?
Yes. You want me to turn it off?
I don't know. It doesn't matter, I suppose. I think it should be called Gideon Putnam, The Man and the Hotel. And the
Gideon Putnam in Saratoga?
No, the hotel. And the hotel, for instance, there's a story in there. Do you remember Mayor Dwyer in New York?
Yes.
Mayor, what was his name? Well, anyway, Dwyer.
The Irish guy.
Irish Catholic. He had a girlfriend called Sloan something, and they were an item in the papers, and they came to Saratoga. Well, today you'd expect that on every news hour all day, but back then you didn't. But an entourage of reporters followed them, and there's a picture of them leaving the Gideon in a stew. Because they've been watched every minute. And I mean, that's just one thing, and it would have to be elaborated on. But today, I mean, you know, you can't breathe but once in the on the television. But that's just one. And but everybody who came there, it's all in the papers. And whoever I assume was Eddie Sweeney's secretary or whoever looked for him, was told to clip everything. Wow. And it's all in them. It's really, I think it would be
what
fun.
Year was it built?
Huh?
What year was the Gideon Putnam Hotel
35.
Built?
35.
So that's just like yesterday.
I know.
To but Mike and I.
But
Mike
that's, but that's all right. Building. It's so, you know, why did they name it that even?
Beautiful.
And the story about Gideon that's in the book, you'd have to elaborate maybe a little, but I don't know. It'll keep me busy for another couple of years. That's why I write books.
Which spring was Mike a dipper boy at?
He was a dipper boy.
Which spring?
Oh,
at the racetrack.
At the track.
At the track. And
you got paid. I told you the story on that.
You got paid for dipping water.
You know, we had a box, cigar box there, and it had some dimes and nickels. And one of the trainers says, "Kid, you got to put some money in there. Put quarters and half dollars." So he did. And for kind of loud, there was still all this money. His mother had to make larger partners when he came home. That's Mike's good friend, Mike Sweeney.
But
he loved the horses, and he wanted to be a jockey, and he got too tall. He told them all the time. I've heard all these stories before. Well, what do you think? Have we had enough?
You guys are great.
Yes, thank you so much.
And you guys are crazy. Thanks.